I guess nearly going on 30 years ago, I was a wrestling fan, so I think the first time I can remember actually seeing wrestling on television, my family lived, of course I was born and raised most of my life in Memphis, Tennessee. My father worked in Memphis at a big Ford Motor Company assembly plant, and I think in about 1958 or something like that, they had a problem with the city. The Ford Motor Company had a problem with the city, and so they shut this assembly plant down that my father worked at, and they built another plant in Lorain, Ohio, and which was like 800 miles from Memphis, and they gave everybody that worked at the plant in Memphis the opportunity to transfer to Ohio and keep their jobs. So our family wound up packing up and moving up to the shores of Lake Erie, about 30 miles west of Cleveland. And we moved there right in the middle of winter. The Lake Erie, I don't know if the Lake Erie was frozen over, and there were several hundred families moving into this little area because of this new plant opening up. And so there was a very big housing shortage, so we had to move into a little lakefront cottage. It was actually usually only in the summertime, ordinarily, for people that wanted to rent these little cottages and be right on the shores of Lake Erie. And we moved there in something like February of 58, and the whole lake was frozen over, and the wind was coming in, and these little cottages didn't have heaters because they were ordinarily just used in the summertime. So we moved right into there, and it was like quite a culture shock coming from Memphis. But that was the first time that I remember seeing wrestling on television. I'm sure we had wrestling on television in Memphis before that, but I don't recall ever seeing it. But when we moved to Ohio, I saw a wrestling show there that featured the Sheik, Bobo Brazil, John and Chris Tolis, and all these, and Johnny Powers, some guys from the Cleveland and Detroit area. And so that's where I really first started to watch wrestling on television and enjoy it. And my father was a big wrestling fan also. We wound up living in Cleveland for about 7 years. And a lot of people wonder why a lot of people that know me today know that I have been a big Cleveland sports fan all my life. And that's really the reason. We moved from Memphis, where they had no professional sports teams at the time, to, just like I said, 30 miles away from Cleveland. And there were, of course, the Cleveland Indians and the Cleveland Browns. And I got my first opportunity to go to a professional baseball game, a professional football game. This was the time that Jim Brown was playing, and the Cleveland Browns were winning championships. And then when we moved back to Memphis, there were still no pro sports team there. So I remained a Cleveland Browns and Cleveland Indians fan my whole life, really. And still am to this day. Unfortunately, through wrestling, I've gotten the opportunity to meet a lot of the players and a lot of the owners and that sort of thing. So it's been a neat sort of love affair with the Cleveland sports team. But as I said, we stayed there for about seven, almost 8 years in Ohio. And then my father had a heart attack and heart condition, so we wound up just able to work from there. We moved back to Memphis. And then when we came back to Memphis, I was just in high school, and I remember that's the first time I remember seeing wrestling on Memphis television. And it, of course, was on Channel 13, and there was Lance Russell and Dave Brown doing the commentary, and of course, all different wrestlers. And I guess that was the first time I realized that wrestling was regionalized, so to speak, because I would talk to the other kids about the wrestlers that I had seen in Ohio. Like the Sheik and Bobo Brazil and these guys, and people in Memphis had never heard of them because it was just the television at that time was regionalized, and they knew people like Jackie Fargo and Tojo Yamamoto and Don and Al Green and the Von Brauners and the guys that were local, I guess the regional stars there in the Memphis area. So I of course got into watching the wrestling there every Saturday morning in Memphis, and Memphis was unique in the fact that at that time they had a live wrestling show every Monday night in Memphis at the downtown auditorium called Ellis Auditorium. And so my father, as I said, was disabled, and work, and I was in high school, had like a learner's permit to drive. So every Monday night, I would drive my dad, and he and I would go down to the wrestling matches there in Memphis. And that was my first actually seeing a live event. And you know, I was like hooked in. I was just like a big fan. And I remember, I don't know why, but I guess they were just more, at least to me, seemed like more charismatic or more risk taking. But I was, as a lot of people are, I was, a fan of the bad guys. I was the top heel team at the time was a team called the Blue Inferno. And I learned later that they consisted of a guy named Frank Martinez, a couple of Mexican wrestlers, Frank Martinez, and the other guy, he still wrestles now to this day. Oh, gosh. It'll come to me later. But anyway, these guys were flying all over the ring. And I thought maybe the mystery of the mask. And this was back in the era that mask guys, it was really neat because nobody really knew their identity. There wasn't an internet where everybody would find out all of the scoops about everybody. These mask guys were really mysterious. And I remember, after the matches or whatever, hang out and try to see these guys without their mask or coming into the auditoriums and that sort of thing. But anyway, then a lot of people do these days, they actually call them something, backyard federations or whatever, that sort of thing. But at that time, we lived in Memphis there where I had a brother that was 4 years older than me. And then next door to my brother and I, or next door to our house, there were a group of boys called the Mike, Danny, David, Dickie, Mashford, four brothers. And so we all, we were like, there were like six of us there, and we all wrestled around. And Mike and I especially, we wound up really imitating everything that we saw on television, as all these wrestlers do. And, right in the backyard, body slamming each other on the ground, this sort of thing. And we just thought it was neat. We just enjoyed the wrestling and enjoyed emulating the guys that we saw and trying to do everything that we saw them do on television. But the way that I finally got to actually meet a professional wrestler for the first time was through my artwork. And a lot of people may or may not know that I do artwork and I've been able to draw ever since I can remember. And one of the things I started doing at the matches, I would draw these cartoons or caricatures of the wrestlers, and spend a lot of my time, actually too much time, when I should have been doing schoolwork. I would be drawing wrestlers and that sort of thing. And I took some of the drawings to the match on Monday night and let the other fans around there see my old caricatures. Maybe I'd draw Jackson Fargo body slamming Tojo Yamamoto right through the ring, and coming out the bottom of the floor of the ring and that sort of stuff. And there was an old man and lady that, of course, long since passed away now, but they just were really nice. The man, for some reason, I had never thought of it. The man said, "You want to send some of those drawings to Lance Russell over Channel 13 and see what they think about it." Converting things. I did it the following week. Put together six or seven little drawings of what had taken place at the matches in Memphis that the previous week. Sent them to Channel 13, attention Lance Russell. I don't even know what I expected. I didn't necessarily expect to hear from anybody on them. But the following Saturday morning, I turned on the television, 11 o'clock, sit down to watch the show, and I looked. And I could see, as Lance Day came on the screen to talk about who was going to wrestle that day, I could see on the corner of his desk, I could see my pictures were still in there, my drawings. And I went, "Oh my gosh, I can't believe it. My drawings are on the desk. They're going to show my drawings." And sure enough, about you know, 30 minutes into the show, they always had a segment where they would recap the action that had taken place the previous Monday and then talk about the upcoming matches for this coming Monday. And Lance just out of loose to say, you know, we're going to tell you about what went on down at the auditorium this past weekend. As a matter of fact, we have some drawings here from a young man named Jerry Lawler that kind of we're going to show you as we talk about the action. Wow. He would talk about the match, and what I did, he held up my drawings, and they were like full screen on the thing, and I'm just sitting there going, wow, this is like the neatest thing that ever happened, you know? So, I thought this was great, but then the really great thing was after the show was over, I'm telling my mom, can I show my pictures on the wrestling? I'm calling the next door neighbors and that sort of thing. And then while I was floating around on Cloud 9, my telephone rang, and answered the phone, and the voice was unmistakable. It was deep voice. Jerry Lawler. Jerry, this is Lance Russell. Gosh, I can't believe Lance Russell called me on the phone. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, we really enjoyed your drawings, and everybody really liked the drawings. And we were just wondering if you wanted to, maybe next week you could send us some more drawings, or this week, and we would use those to, to illustrate what went on at the matches. And, of course, I thought this was great. And so I sent more drawings in the next week. So they showed them again. The following week, they showed them again. After about, I think, 3 or 4 weeks, Lance called me up again, and this was unbelievable. He called me again and said, you know, everybody just really is enjoying your drawings, and we thought we'd invite you to come over and actually be on TV with us and sit there at the desk, and you hold up your drawings and let the people see who's actually doing these illustrations. So, of course, this was like a dream come true. I'm going to get to go and actually be on the wrestling show. And so, sure enough, that was my first opportunity to be on a wrestling show. But while I was there, I got to meet Lance, took me around and introduced me to a lot of the wrestlers. And one of the guys, of course, he was everybody's hero in Memphis, he was a big star, was the fabulous Jackie Fargo. And Jackie was, Jackie was like, I idolized Jackie Fargo. And Jackie actually beat him and shake hands with him. It was the neatest thing in the world. And then what was even cooler was Jackie liked the artwork and the caricature that I had done of him. And Jackie was into a phase of his career where he was, of course, using his wrestling popularity to sort of branch off into other directions. And sort of a local country music star named Eddie Bond had opened a nightclub in Memphis called the Southern Frontier. And so Jackie asked me if I would be able to come down to their nightclub and paint like little cartoon characters of Jackie and Eddie Bond. I thought at first he meant maybe just paint one or two, and finally I found out really Jackie really liked looking at these little pictures of himself, because I went about that. I painted 100 pictures of Jackie and Eddie all over this nightclub. And so it took me literally, it was a work in progress that lasted like for months.
How old were you around this time?
Oh gosh, let's see. I was 17, maybe, I guess, yeah, 17. And so, after I'm doing all of this drawing artwork, I finally finished up all of these caricatures. And I think Jackie was looking at this and Eddie Bond also. These guys were great, not only great self-promoters, but they were great. They always had some kind of angle to try to make a quick buck here or there. And so they both came up with the idea. They said, why don't we start up a little sign company? They said, we'll use our name, and you do the artwork, and we'll call it Bond Fargo Sign Company. And of course, this is before, you get your trucks or whatever, and all the signs done on computer. This is back when people still hand lettered the size of trucks and signs on windows and that sort of thing. So basically, we started up a little sign company, and all of a sudden, I'm working for Jackie Fargo and Eddie Bond. And I'm going to school. I just graduated high school, and because of my artwork, I was fortunate enough to win a commercial art scholarship to the University of Memphis. So I'm going to, at that time it's called Memphis State, I'm going to Memphis State in the morning, and in the afternoon I come up and pick paint signs for Jackie Barber and Eddie Bond. And it gave me an opportunity to kind of be around Jackie Fargo a little bit, and I was really just, you know, fascinated with what I saw. It was like, to me, like the neatest lifestyle ever. You know, this guy that's on television on Saturday morning, he goes down on Monday night, huge crowd, you know, falling all over him when he wrestles. And then he has all these fans, and of course, a lot of pretty women falling around at the nightclub. And I just thought, man, this has got to be the greatest life ever. And so we wound up having me work in a little office that was right next door to the Southern Frontier nightclub. And I'm down there painting, and I was really enjoying being around Jackie Fargo and Eddie Bond, but what I really, of course, had stars in my eyes about was wrestling. And I wasn't, you know, I wasn't big or anything like that, but I did, when I realized this was something I wanted to do, I enrolled in the wrestling, I started wrestling at Memphis State, and at that time, for some reason, I mean, wrestling was big out west, but in the south of Memphis, especially Memphis State, just the collegiate wrestling hadn't really caught on. It just wasn't as big. They didn't have much of a program. Matter of fact, the host and body, we had five guys turn out for wrestling. And the baseball coach doubled as the wrestling coach. And of course, we just took a back seat to baseball. And they didn't have enough guys to like field a competitive team and compete against the other universities. But we did get a basic amateur wrestling background while I was there. And I'm thinking in my mind, one of these days, I'm going to be nervous to tell Jackie Fargo that I'm wrestling here at college, and I would love to try to wrestle for the Memphis organization. But of course, I just didn't really have the nerve to do that at that time. So anyway, one day, I'm doing my little artwork, painting some signs there, and knock on the door, and this young guy comes in, not much older than me, maybe 22 or 23 years old. And his name was Jerry Vickers, and he was from Missouri, and walked in and introduced himself, and he said he's looking for Jackie Fargo. I said, well, you know, of course he's not here right now. Jackie didn't get introduced until about 7 or 8 at night, but I said, this is the club, and he said, you know, what do you want with me? He said, well, I'm just in from Missouri, and I've wrestled a little bit, and I just want to talk to him about wrestling here in Memphis. I want to find out who you talk to and who you have to know to get booked. And so I thought, here was my fountain of information. You know, here's the guy. And I wasn't intimidated by this guy at all because, you know, like I said, he looked much older than me. And I said, well, you know what? I said, I've been wondering the same thing. I said, you know, I've been working here for Jackie, and I want to wrestle really bad, and I was wondering how you go about breaking into the business. How would you ever have your first match or get somebody to look at you and see you wrestling? And so I still to this day think that this is just an opportunity for this guy to make a few bucks off of me, because, you know, he didn't know me from Adam and could care less probably about helping me. But he said, well, of course, the first thing you have to do is you have to have wrestling tights and wrestling boots. Do you have any of that? Because I didn't know where you would get those things. I said, no, I don't. And he said, well, you know what? He said, I have a pair of boots, like I said, and a couple of pairs of trunks. I said, wow, this is crazy. I said, well, yeah, I'd be glad to buy them, you know. And he said, okay. So he goes out to his car, comes back in, he's got a pair of wrestling boots that were about a size too big for me. But anyway, this was like somebody offered me, you know, a buried treasure or something. I thought, this is the greatest thing ever. So I bought the wrestling boots and the trunks from this guy, and I thought, well, I'm almost there. I'm on the way to being a professional wrestler. And then, though, he told me, he said, well, what do you think? Of course, you gotta have your first match somewhere. And it's probably going to be really tough to get your first match working for this Memphis organization, which at that time, the promoters and owners of the territory were Nick Goulas and Roy Welch. And they had promoted wrestling in Memphis for probably about 30 years or so. And he said, but, you know, there's a little organization over across the bridge in West Memphis, Arkansas, that just has little small matches on Saturday night, and they have them in this little place called the Avon Theater, which is a little rundown movie theater that had gone out of business, and just in this wrestling promoter guy was renting it. He'd taken out like the first 10 rows of seats instead of wrestling rain down right in front of the movie screen. And I'll never forget the first time I went over there, that rain was sitting down there. Of course, all the seats were kind of dilapidated. And over the ring, for a ring light, this big wire was hanging down. And there was this big galvanized wash tub upside down with about six or seven light bulbs inside it. That was his ring light. But anyway, Jerry Bricker said, you know, you might go across there with me. He said, I'm going to wrestle over there for this guy Saturday night. He said, I'll take you over there. And the only thing you got to do is don't tell him that you've never wrestled before. If he asked you if you wrestled, you just say, yeah, you wrestled in Florida or something like that. So anyway, I said, okay, that'll be great. But between that time and that Saturday, I went over, and Jerry Vickers was actually staying with a professional wrestler that lived there in Memphis that he knew. I went over, and we went out in his backyard, and Jerry showed me a few things. So I said, tomorrow we're going to go over and meet the West Memphis promoter, the guy named Aubrey Griffin. So I got a little bit ahead of myself here. But in the meantime, one of the other things that Jackie Fargo and Eddie Bond did there in Memphis was they had a nightclub. Eddie was a country music singer, Jackie was a wrestler. And then Eddie was also the program director at a little sort of rinky-dink country music station there called KWAM, KWAM. And it didn't get out very far, but as I said, they played country music. Eddie Bond did the morning show on there, and Jackie Fargo had an afternoon slot where he was on the radio just as a personality, like 3 to 5. After I'd been working for those guys for a few months, they actually, well, of course, I knew about them being on the radio, so I was taking wrestling at the University of Memphis, and I also took another course in broadcasting because I was thinking, you know, one of these days I'll tell these, if I can't get into wrestling, maybe I can help use these guys to get me in radio. And so, sure enough, after a while, I told everybody that I was doing the radio stuff, so they gave me a little shift on at night. I was actually on from like 7 to midnight at the time when nobody listened and nobody wanted to work. So they put me in the studio, which was a little Quonset hut over the really bad part of town. It was just a really rinky radio station. But anyway, we were going to go and meet the West Memphis wrestling promoter the next day. So I got up all excited. Jerry Vickers called me. I met him. We go over, and sure enough, we walk in. That was my first time to see this little movie theater. And I'll never forget meeting Aubrey Griffin. I think I had remembered seeing him wrestle a time or two for the Memphis organization, but he was older now and was running this little operation in Eastern Arkansas. So Jerry Vickers always knew this guy. He said he was going to wrestle for him this coming Saturday night. Jerry said, Aubrey, I saw a young man with me from Memphis. Interested in wrestling over here in West Memphis. And sure enough, the very first words out of Aubrey's mouth were, he said, well, have you ever wrestled before, son? And I said, yes, sir. And I felt like my face was like a neon sign. I just like, I know he said, I'm lying. But he said, and I think he knew it, because then the next words he said, yeah, where'd you wrestle? And I said, down in Florida. Two answers that Jerry Vickers had given. Unfortunately, he didn't give me any other answers further than that. And the next question out of Aubrey Griffin's mouth was, yeah, what promoter did you wrestle for down there? And I said, I can't remember. And of course, Jerry Vickers gave me a nudge and said, Eddie Graham, wasn't it Eddie Graham? And I said, yeah, Eddie Graham. And of course, the guy knew I was lying. So he said, well, I'll tell you what, he said, I don't have any openings right now, but, you know, leave me a number, and if something comes up, I'll call you. And so I knew, you know, I'd blown my big chance right there, and so I wasn't even thinking about saying this when I went in there, but just all of a sudden I blurted out, well, I just thought that if I was wrestling over here for you, I could talk about it on my radio show every night on KWAM Radio. And then all of a sudden this guy died with us. You're on the radio? So, I do a show every night, 7 to midnight on KWAM Radio. Country music, a lot of wrestling fans listening. He said, Well, all right, and you could talk about our matches here in West Memphis on your show if you were wrestling.
Sure.
So he said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, I'll put you and Jerry in a tag match this Saturday night. I could have left there, and Jerry Lucas would tell me, that was great, man. What a great idea. And can you really talk about it on the radio? I said, sure. So, sure enough, I started, you know, that night, man, I started blowing it out. I telling everybody, you know, between every record, oh, this is great wrestling action coming to West Memphis, Arkansas. And I went and got sound effects of the bell ringing and the roaring crowd, you know, and I made it. It was, you hear me talk about it, it sounded like it was going to be Madison Square Garden, of course, West Memphis. And plugged it all week long, all excited, got over there to the Avon Theater, and of course I never really knew. Nobody had ever really sat down and told me what wrestling was like. The only inkling that I had, was one time when I was going to the wrestling matches that I was on tour. One of the guys that worked concessions there once told me, and I was the biggest wrestling fan ever. I know these guys. I know they were killing each other. But somehow I knew surely they weren't really killing each other or they would be dead. And one day, one of the concession guys told me, you know what? He said, these guys actually go downstairs and they all talk to me and talk to these guys. So, get in. Show you? Huh. Yeah. So, you know, it's like right before the matches are going to start, and we go back to the back of the concession room, down some steps, open up a little door. Sure enough, there's a big room, and there's two wrestlers that are going to wrestle against each other in the first match, and they're sitting there talking to each other. Because we were way away, but I can see them sitting there talking. Cool. So that was really basically the only true knowledge that I had about wrestling. I never told the Jerry Vickers guy that I wasn't smart or that it was smart or anything. It just didn't really come up. I guess he just assumed that I was working the Jack Club or that was. So we were wrestling the big stars at Memphis at that time were a team called the Interns, managed by Dr. Ken Rain. And Star and Jim Star. But anyway, they were the big stars at Memphis. And in West Memphis, they had a sort of little ripoff tag team called the Executioners. They had little white outfits and everything. And they were a couple of pretty big burly guys, and of course not anywhere near the caliber of the real Interns. And so that's who they had Jerry Vickers on. And sure enough, the promoter, Aubrey Griffith, comes in and says to Jerry and I, you know, I go in and I'm just looking around and I see all the wrestlers. And we were dressing behind, in a little room behind the movie screen. And I don't know if anybody's ever been behind a movie screen, but it's really cool. It's all perforated. And it's one of those deals where when you were on that side, you could look out and see out there, but the people inside couldn't see you. And I'm thinking, wow, I wonder if they could see us like we see them. You know, these guys in there naked, these guys talking about a match and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, you can look out there and you can see the people out there. Obviously, they couldn't see us, but that's when the promoter came over and got Jerry and I together with these guys who were going to wrestle. And, you know, I'm soaking it all in, but I didn't want to crack to let anybody know that this was like my losing my virginity as far as wrestling goes, but that's what was happening. And, you know, he said, you know, why don't you guys go up there and have a good match? And, after about 15 or 20 minutes, one of the executioners will take it to fall on Jerry Vickers. So, wow. That really were talking about the match down there in the auditorium, right? So, The match didn't go exactly as I had planned or hoped, because I wanted to try a move that I had seen the Blue Infernos do over the numbers. And the Blue Infernos did it to a wrestler that the only reason I remember his name is because of this particular move that I tried to emulate. They were wrestling some young guy that was named Young Anaya. And somewhere in the match, they just grabbed his kid. They've been beating on him a little bit. They just grabbed him by the seat of his tights and by his hair and just ran him across the ring and threw him between the top rope and the second rope. And that's a move that's been done a million times, but every time I've ever seen somebody get thrown through the ropes, they somehow grabbed the ropes, hooked the ropes, you know, broke their fall and tumbled out onto the floor. And, you know, that was fine, but this particular guy, this young Anaya, somehow when they grabbed him and they shot him through, he would go sailing through the ropes just like a rocket and not touch anything. I mean, he would obviously put his hands to his side and just sail right through there and all the way out onto the floor and land in some kind of tumbling way and, of course, not kill himself, but it just really looked great. And so I thought, man, that's what I want to do. I love that move. I want to have one of these guys throw me through the ropes. I'm going to sail out there. Everybody's going to go, oh, wow. So anyway, we've been wrestling for maybe 3 or 4 minutes, and Jerry Vickers tagged me in. And just as soon as I got in there, I locked up with the guy. You know, I had no idea how to call him. I locked up with this executioner. Throw me out of the ring. He grabbed me by the hair just like Young Anaya, runs me across the ring. Here I go, man. I got my hands on the side. I'm sailing out head first. And the next thing I can remember is I'm back behind the movie screen again, back in the dressing room, and I lay out my hair for the guy that's trying to find the towel. And I'm like, and they said, you all right? You all right? And I'm like, huh? And I'm like coming to, and I'm regaining consciousness. And I said, yeah. Oh, the last thing I remember was hearing a big loud noise. And they said, yeah, that big loud noise was your head hit the concrete floor when you sailed out of the ring. And so that was my very first match. And it lasted, like I said, about 4 minutes, and I got knocked out like a light because I had no clue of what I was doing. But it was, like, to me, the greatest moment of my life. And I went back the next Saturday, and the next Saturday, we wrestled 7 weeks there. And every week on the radio, I would plug these matches even more and more. I think the first week I wrestled there, they had, like, 23 people, and the crowd started coming up. The next week, we had like 30 people, and then the fourth week, it was up to like 45 people, and everybody was getting all excited. And I think finally, after about the fifth week, we finally brought like 100 people in the crowd. We said, well, this is great. And so they all attributed to the you know, extra plugs on the radio. And then one day, of course, you know, Jackie Fargo had never said a word again. I still didn't have the nerve to tell Jackie Fargo that I was wrestling or anything like that. But I'm sure he heard about me plugging it on my radio show. So after about the fifth week, I walked in. I'm getting ready to do. Well, I went to the radio station that afternoon, and I'll never forget. Eddie Bond was sitting on the telephone. He's talking to somebody. I walked in, and he goes. And he's going, no, Jackie, don't do that. Come on. He's a good kid. Don't do that. And so I'm listening. And there's Eddie Bond is talking to Jackie Fargo. He said, no, that's a bunch of shit. He said, this kid, he's over there, he's putting on fake wrestling matches, and he's giving us a bad name. And Eddie said, well, don't do it, Jackie. He said, no. He said, we're not going to take it anymore. He said, me and Dennis Hall and several of the guys, Don L. Green, we're going to go over there Saturday night, and we're going to kick their asses. And Eddie said, don't hurt the kid. He said, no, that's bullshit. He said, we're going to hurt them all. We're going to break somebody's arm or something. He said, we're not going to stand those guys putting on a bunch of fake wrestling matches. I put the phone down. Eddie hangs up. And Jerry, that's hot. I wouldn't know what they're saying. So now I'm scared of them. I called up. called up, first of all, Gary Vickers. And then he said, well, call Aubrey Griffin. And I called the Aubrey Griffin, who, of course, had worked for years for Google and said, well, I said, Aubrey, we can't have a match today. Why not? I said, well, the real wrestlers are going to come over and beat all our and break our arms or legs or something. And he said, what are you talking about? So I told him, I said, I heard Jack Bonner telling Eddie Bonner on the phone. And he said, oh, man. He said, all he's trying to do is discourage you. He said, because we're what you call outlaw wrestling. And he said, they look at us as competition. I don't know why, but he said, you know, they look at this as outlaw wrestling, and they just try to discourage it any way they can. And they know you're talking about it on the radio, so they just want you to stop. And I said, are you sure? And he said, trust me. Jackie Fargo and Al Green and Don Green are not going to come to West Memphis, Arkansas Saturday night. And so I'll bet my life on. So anyway, we went over there Saturday night, and I'm going to go there and make a sense of story. We got to watch each other's back. And there was a country, there was a popular country music song at that time by a guy named, some guy that was on Hee Haw. I think his name was Jerry somehow. But anyway, it was about a rabbit that could run real fast. And it said, the words to it was, that's all right, my ears may be thin, but I can burn the wind. Or I can run so fast, I'll burn the wind. So I'll never forget Jerry Vickers said, when I'm in the ring, you watch the back door. When you're in the ring, I watch the back door. If anybody comes through to do it, looks like a wrestler, we'll burn the wind. And so, sure enough, you know, we would go and wrestle, and no wrestlers showed up. And that's when I knew that these guys were right. They were just trying to discourage me from being involved with the outlaw wrestling. And the following week, I guess Jackie knew that I sort of called his bluff. The following week, Jackie Fargo came to me and said, look, kid, I guess instead of trying to be a wrestler, he said, if I get you a match with Nick Gulas' organization, will you quit fooling that crap over in West Memphis, Arkansas? Oh my gosh, absolutely. That's, you know, that's all I wanted. I was just embarrassed to ask you. And so he said, all right. He said, I'll get you a match for Nick Gulas. Oh my gosh, I'm going to be wrestling for the real Memphis wrestling organization. Next week, I got a phone call from. I don't think it was Nick Gulas. Somebody in the office, probably Christine Jarrett. And they said, we need you to have you book to wrestle this Saturday morning on Memphis television. And little did I know at the time that, you know, wrestling on Memphis television, just being a job guy, getting beat by somebody in a few minutes was like the lowest rung of the ladder of any wrestling. But I thought it was the best. I thought that was the biggest thing. I thought you'd play up to wrestling forever before you actually got to wrestle on television. So I was in heaven. Man, I'm a television wrestler already, right off the bat, my first match. And my first match on Channel 13 that Saturday morning was, I think, against the interns, the real interns. And they just slaughtered me and my partner. But I mean, probably in less than a minute, but it was like amazing. You know, I loved it. And then I got, after a couple of weeks of television, getting beat bad on television, they booked me in a match in Jonesboro, Arkansas, which was my first house show. And they booked me against Tojo Yamamoto, who Tojo was this little Japanese guy that. Oh gosh, the poor old guy. I mean, he was really mean and tough, at least everybody's the outward appearance. And he had no family, and he was kind of a loner, and he just really did. He was in a bad mood all the time. And he really resented young guys coming into the business for some reason. And Tojo was just always real tough on the young guys that were trying to start out. And I found out later that they would book young guys against Tojo because he would literally beat you up so bad in your match with him that if you came back, then they said, well, this guy's got potential. Because Tojo would usually make guys have other ideas about being a professional wrestler. So I had my first match with Tojo in Jonesboro, Arkansas, and I thought he was going to kill me. I mean, he would slap you so hard with the chops and And you think you still have the whole thing with the Japanese karate, you know, you think you still have the back of the neck kicking or something, just everything so stiff that, that literally you thought you were going to die. And so he beat on me for probably 10 or 12 minutes, and then of course beat me. And I went back to the dressing room, and Jackie Barber was there waiting. I was good. Didn't want to be a wrestler. And there was like no doubt. I mean, even though I got my brains beat out, I just loved it. That was the first time in front of a kind of a big crowd. And I said, oh, yeah, absolutely. So for about 4 weeks straight, they put me against Tokyo. And every week it would be worse than it did the week before. And I guess just by the fact that I kept coming back and kept asking to wrestle again, they said, well, you know, the kid really does have potential. He's got some staying power. He's not just going to be a fly-by-night guy and leave. So after about 4 weeks, they started adjusting from some other guys started actually booking me out in the territory. What happened was that I had to make a decision because I was going to be traveling quite a bit, and rather than just wrestling on Saturday night, they wanted to start booking me all through the week on a full-time basis. So then I had to make a decision about giving up not only the radio show at night, but more importantly, giving up basically quitting college. And so I guess I made the right decision. I don't know, but anyway, I quit Memphis State and started wrestling full-time.
What were some of the other veterans that helped you?
You know, I don't know if any, I can honestly say, of course, Jackie Parker, most and foremost. But really, helping me learn the business, I sort of just kind of bluffed my way through it. It was like I never really, I didn't really give the impression, I guess, that I was a complete novice. Fortunately, I was not trying to sound conceited or arrogant or anything, but I was pretty good from the get-go, and it wasn't like guys. I mean, of course, when I wrestled all of these guys that like the interns and the creeds and all of these established veterans, so to speak, I learned every time I was in the ring, but it wasn't that they were necessarily going out of their way to help me. But they were just doing whatever they had to do to try to have a good match. There was another wrestler named Buddy Wayne Peel. And he helped me in the fact that he would actually ask Nick Gulas to have me wrestle in his town. And that, you know, that exposure, of course, that getting able to wrestle more often helped a lot. But mostly Jackie Fargo.
How influential was Jerry Jarrett to you?
Oh, well, Jerry Jarrett was, I don't know if influential is a big word. Jerry was of course, a big part of my career. Later on, when we became business partners. But Jerry was starting out at basically the same time I was. Well, actually, he started a little bit before me. But the difference was Jerry grew up in a wrestling family. His mother, Christine Jarrett, was Nick Gulas and Roy Welch's secretary in the wrestling office there in Nashville for something like 17 years before Jerry actually got into business. And so he had come up with inside knowledge of wrestling, knowing more so about how the office and the business end of the business works, more so than the in-ring stuff. And then he started out by promoting towns and booking towns. And I don't really know why, because I really wasn't close friends with Jerry. But then Jerry started wrestling. And I'll never forget, that was the first time a guy that was, Jerry was not big physically or anything like that. He was a small guy and not big muscles or anything like that. And I'll never forget, a lot of the people thought, well, a lot of the other wrestlers were saying, you know, I mean, this guy, he's only getting to wrestle because his mother works in the office and because he works in the office and that sort of thing. But I didn't even realize at the time that he was like helping book the towns for Nick Gulas and Roy Welch, and that he was sort of the brains behind a lot of these shows. And so actually, Jerry and I had a little bit of a falling out right off the bat because they started using me a little bit. And on some of the same shows that Jerry was on, it was Huntsville, Alabama one night. He came over to me and sat down. First time I really talked to him, he came over and sat down and said, "Hey, I want to make a little suggestion about what I saw you doing in the match out there." And as I said, I didn't know. I just thought Jerry was one of the other wrestlers. And, you know, young guy, not too much older than me. And so he gave me some sort of suggestion about what he thought I should do. And I'm thinking to myself, I don't remember what he told me, but I do know that my famous words to him was after he sat there and gave me his suggestion. I looked over at him and I said, "Hey, you wrestle your way, I'll wrestle my way." Okay? The next week, somehow I was sent to Montgomery, Alabama, which was like the worse than the farm club. I mean, it was like going from the major leagues down to single-A baseball. And I didn't realize at the time that it was Jerry Jarrett that was behind it. But I found out really quickly that Jerry was one of the bosses. And so, in actuality, though, moving or getting sent down to the Alabama territory, which was a little feeder organization, a little training organization for Gulas and Welch's bigger territory, it really was the best thing that ever happened to me, because I got to wrestle with guys that were more on my skill level, and I got to be put in more important matches, whereas in for Gulas and Welch, I was just wrestling open matches to get beat every night. When I went to Alabama, because, you know, I was, as I said, either equal or better than a lot of the talent that was there, I got put into feature matches in that area, main events, and that's where I met Sam Bass and Jim White. We hooked up as a tag team there and did so well there that we eventually got noticed again by Jerry Jarrett and Nick Lewis and got called back up.
How about you in, I guess it was late 70s or late 80s?
The late 70s, I don't know. It's like I was heel, baby face, whatever, so many times. I think I started out as baby face, but then when it got shipped down to Alabama, came back from Alabama in like 73 or 74 or something like that. And that's when I came back as a heel, with Sam Bass managing me, stayed heel probably until after Sam Bass.
Now, would you say that one of your big matches would be with Jack Russo? Is that like one of the big turning points in your career?
Oh, well, what happened, I guess the way I even got to wrestle Jack Russo was the fact that I for some reason, was always a fan of, as I said, I was a fan of the bad guys, but I was a fan of more of the high-flying, acrobatic-type wrestling and the big bumps and that sort of thing than I was the big, plodding, slow, get a hold and hold it for 15-minute-type matches. And we, in the Tennessee territory at that time, they had a lot of big guys that wrestled that style. In terms were pretty good bump takers, but then there were guys like Don Alvarez that were bigger and more methodical, and the Farm Brawlers were more just a pounding type tag team, and there weren't really any what you call high flyers and that sort of thing. Well, Jim White and I came into the territory, and that's the part of the business I enjoyed, was taking bumps. And I would go out in the match and the fun of the match and what I felt like got me over was flying around and taking bumps, where most of the guys' mentality at that time, the heel's mentality, was what they thought got them over was beating the baby faces down and pounding and looking strong. And so the funny thing happened, guys like Jerry Jarrett, Tojo Namamoto were like the top babyface team, and and Jackie Fargo was interchanged in and out of it. And when they wrestled against, and these guys were always in the main event, when they wrestled against guys like Greens and Lombardos and Eaters, they would just get pounded down, and of course they would eventually win, but it was just like most of the match they were stuck. And so they're looking at us down on the opening matches, and we're flying around, taking bumps, getting beat, and of course the fans are cheering for the guys that we're wrestling like crazy, because we're making these guys look like $1 million. And so it didn't take very long that Jerry Jarrett came to me, and I was actually with Jack and Thomas, hey, we work a program with Law and White, and these guys make us look, make us look good. And so, sure enough, that's what happened. We got moved right up simply because of the way, the way, the style that we worked. We were more selling type, and begging off and being a cowardly type deal as opposed to being a big strong deal. And for some reason, I just clicked. It got over, and we started drawing big houses. After after about a year or so, Jim White moved, left the team, moved out of Memphis, and so I went to become a single wrestler. And they, of course, I can't take credit for this. Anyway, they just got the idea to push me into title contention. And I'll never forget the way they did it. They looked down around and they kicked out like the top 10. They told people, King's going to go on a, Jerry Lawler's going to go on this quest for the title, but in order to get a title shot, he's got to go through the top 10 contenders. And they had a list of, Terry Funk, Dory Funk, the Sheik, Bobo Brazil, Dick DeBruza, all of these big names that people had only read about in magazines or things. And that's what these guys had not really ever even come to them, but the people knew that they were big national stars. And this was the first time that the promoters, Gules and Welch, and I think Jerry Jarrett was the one that talked to them into doing it, actually went to the expense of paying the trans and flying these guys in, these big stars into Memphis to wrestle me, and the people just got swept up into it. And all of this was to try to get a shot at Jack Briscoe, who was at the time the NWA World Champion. I got to wrestle. The funny thing was, this was one of my shining moments as far as being a talker or doing interviews, because every one of these top 10 guys that came in, once they saw me, without exception, they all refused to put me over. It was like, we had the idea that I would come in, I would get to win over all of these guys and then face Jack Briscoe. But I didn't realize that all these guys didn't always do business that way. They would all get there. I'll never forget the Sheik came down and I went back to his dressing room and sat down beside him and started talking to him a little bit. And he was getting clothes on and all this kind of stuff, getting his gear out. And I'm trying to make small talk. And after a little while, he said, "Kid, do you know who I'm wrestling tonight?" And I said, "Yeah, me." And he said, "Oh, I thought you were like the ring crew or something." So anyway, it boiled down to a lot of these guys got disqualified or one way or the other or count out or some sort of thing. Sam Bass interfered. But anyway, I was able to talk my way after the match and convince everybody on television that I had won each one of these matches. And so finally got to wrestle Jack Briscoe. And that, that was probably one of the biggest matches as far as instant credibility. But I think this quest for the title thing really led up to that and made that match that big.
You kind of just touched on your skills with the mic. How did you develop your skills? Because, probably one of the best offers in the business.
Well, I think without a doubt, without a doubt being on the radio beforehand, but I still got to go back once again and credit Jackie Barlow and Eddie Bond for giving me that opportunity. And a couple of guys, one guy that was a disc jockey there in Memphis and has now gone on to be one of the most famous DJs in the country. He's still on the biggest rock station in New York City right now. His name's Scott Shannon. At that time, Scott Shannon was a DJ in Memphis, and I, once again, through my art, I entered an art contest with Scott Shannon a new radio station put on and won the art contest. I got to meet Scott and befriended him, and he gave me a lot of pointers on radio stuff and that kind of thing. I just think that background helped me, know what it took to be a communicator or communicate your thoughts to the people that were out there watching, and not to be, not to be afraid of the camera, and not to be, to know that the first thing you can have to say is just basically keep talking all the time, and that was a big part of it.
At what point did you start to get your book and use some of your ideas on TV?
Oh, well, that wasn't until after Jerry Jarrett and I had basically gone into business for ourselves, and that came about in, I think, 1977. Jerry was working for Nate Lewis and Roy Welch, and he was booking the Memphis area. The Tennessee territory was divided into sort of two ends. There was the Memphis end and the Birmingham end. And there were enough wrestlers in this area that you could book two cities every night and have a full crew in each one of the cities. And the Memphis end consisted of Memphis and Jackson and Jackson City, Memphis, Tennessee, Jonesboro, Arkansas, Tupelo, Mississippi, and Evansville, Indiana. And the Birmingham end had Birmingham and Huntsville and Nashville and Bowling Green and Memphis and also at Louisville. And so Jerry was booking the Memphis in, and Ed was booking the Birmingham in. And the Memphis in, where Jerry was wrestling Jackie Fargo and Tojo and myself and Jim White, was like doing record business. We were drawing really big crowds and selling out week in and week out in almost all of the cities. And Birmingham was really not doing very well. And one of the reasons Birmingham wasn't doing very well was because Nick Lewis had a son named George who had become about 20 or 22 years old and decided that he wanted to be a wrestler. And George was not very gifted athletically. Even had a little bit of a speech impediment and zero charisma. And was not very well liked simply because he was a father's son. And Nick decided that if his son George, which was his only child, his son George wanted to be a wrestler, then he was going to be a wrestler. He didn't care what anybody thought. He didn't care what the other wrestlers wanted. He didn't care what the fans wanted. So Nick took his son George and pushed him into the limelight and into the main events and all of the towns on the Birmingham end. And the people just thought that sucked, and they resented him. They knew he was only there because he was the boss's son, and they just quit coming. They just quit coming and drove. And so Nick is sitting there looking at his end doing terrible, and Memphis end selling out. And George is looking at that also, and George is going out wrestling some of nobody over in Birmingham. Well, Memphis, we had 11,500 people at the Coliseum. So George went to Nick and said, "Dad, I want to wrestle in Memphis." Right. And so then Nick went to Jerry Jarrett and said, "Jerry, I want you to book a boy over in Memphis." And Jerry said, "No, Nick, I'm not going to book boys in Memphis. We're doing great. We're selling out. I'm not going to change things." And of course, George was Nick's son, and Nick said, "Hey, boy, this is my territory, and I said you're going to go to Georgia and Memphis." And apparently, and I didn't even know all this was going on, Jerry had been paying into Nick a certain amount of money every week or every month to buy part of the territory, to become a part owner of the territory. And so finally, over George, it became this big stalemate, this big standoff. And Nick said, "You are going to book George and Memphis." And Jerry said, "I'm not." And Nick said, "I own this territory, and you are." And Jerry said, "Look, I own part of this territory, too, and I'm not." And Nick said, "Well, you don't own nothing. You ain't been buying nothing." And so Jerry said, "What are you talking about?" And he said, I own all of this territory, and what I say goes. Somehow Jerry Checkney stood up, you know, apparently what he was buying, Nick was taking money, but Jerry was not getting any stock or any percentage of the territory or anything like that. So Jerry said, went to Nick, and he basically quit. He said, you know, I'm going to go in business on my own.